Okay. So let's start saying, what is this AD, Anno Domini, which is in the language that Latin, right? Mm-hmm. Latin. Okay, and John, which was the one, the youngest, beloved John, that they used to tell the beloved one, right? Said that on that Anno Domini, the true light that came to the world enlightened mankind. Right? Yeah. We have this habit of putting initials to everything, right? So we use the A dot, D dot. So when it is before Christ, it will be C, right? But since Christ came, we're using AD, Anno Domini. So that's the year that Christianity started. And we're counting the years, the centuries of the coming of Jesus. But this is said over here, is the acronym. Nobody knows what acronym is, it's also AD is the acronym for the beginning of the Christian era, when God sent to the world the greatest missionary of all times. Jesus Christ came to the world with a live message of love, fraternity, hope, talking straight to our hearts and minds, reminding us of the importance of the things of the Spirit. Okay, we know that, I'm sure. But on that Anno Domini that Jesus started, the world was sinking in moral decadence. Moral decadence, this is strong. Slowing down the evolutionary process of mankind in the direction of spirituality. What is this sinking in moral? Where did Jesus came? In what situation? Okay, I think we know, right? Because the Hebrews, he came to the Hebrews. The prophets on the Bible were saying that somebody would come, the Savior, right? The Hebrews were believing in one only God. Remember that? That was the principle, the main reason why Jesus came to that region, to the Hebrews, to Jerusalem, all that, right? And even though they were believing in one only God, because that was not the situation around, because the Romans, right, they believed in many gods, the Greek, believe in many gods, and all other cultures and religions are believing in many gods. Just the Hebrews, the Jews, like we say, right? But then, about that, believing in one only God, at the same time, the prophecies were saying that a Savior was coming in a time like we said before over here. Ignorance, right? So, what they were believing in? Power, right? The matter, the power of money, right? Of the armies, right? What other power? Violence. Strength, the strength of the armies. So even in the Bible at this time, if we think about, was saying the God of the armies. Remember that? That was in the Bible. The God of the armies was saying that. So they were expecting somebody to save them from the domination, from slavery. They could never expect somebody. The first word he said was, Well, what you talking about? What you hear saying? What you talking to a lot of people? A lot of people following you. But say what you do. Say what you do. So he said, love God. Love. Remember that? Mm-hmm. Love God and thy neighbor like yourself. And love the neighbor like yourself. Mm-hmm. Right? That was the big difference. Nobody before was saying love related to any philosophy, to any point of view. Nothing like that was going to happen. So this changed completely. So these teachings came to enlighten the shadows of the world and to drive mankind in the direction of spirituality that leads to God, the supreme destination of all men. We know that. We know the Spiritist doctrine is always telling us something about we are incarnated spirits, right? God could never come straight to us. Because we have this concept that God being a wise man, you know, with bird, white bird, right? And we are not really into that anymore. We know that it's a big conscious, right? We know that we were created to God's image, not because of our bodies, our physical bodies, but because of our spirit. And something that spirit relates us to God. And what relates us to God is our consciousness. Because the consciousness is not even in the brain. The consciousness is in the spirit, is in our spiritual body. Right? I think that everybody that studied a little bit or likes Spiritism doctrine knows about that. So, in that way, that's the link that I do here for thinking about what we're talking about, spirituality, right? But we'll go ahead. So, in that way, because even nowadays, we're not really understanding this link between philosophy, science, religion, which is the Spiritism proposal, right? Science all the time. Kardec used to say that if we are in doubt, nothing in the doctrine that is said in the doctrine was already surpassed by science. But Kardec, put this possibility. He put, even if there is a doubt about what you're saying here, what the spirits are saying also here, and science, stay with science, he said. Why? Because we need to know, to have conscience, we need to understand how things work, right? And when we say understanding, mean that we are working our intellect, our minds together. Because nobody is capable of change something in the behavior if you don't understand what's going on. And that's the thing. How can we, in that way, get into the direction of some inner reformation? Because Jesus came over here, he never opened any church, any religion. He didn't start any religion or said to us, listen, you need to go to the synagogue to save yourself. Never. He was preaching outside by the lake that they call sea. What was a lake indeed? Galilee Sea. Yeah. But he was over there talking, parables, some stuff that, like we heard here on the Gospel Moment, things that we didn't even understand don't make sense. Some of the things that Jesus said don't make sense if we go with that mind very straight, not understanding the spirit, not understanding that we have the strength of spirit. We have the spirit before the matter, the spirit commanding the matter, the spirit capable of growth. What is capable of growth is the spirit, right? So, how can we talk about inner reformation if we don't relate very well these words, the spiritual words, the spiritual sense of Jesus to our behavior, our way of thinking? If we don't understand that, we're not capable of any reformation, because this reformation is only possible for us in this world, the level, the spiritual level that we are in this world, with Jesus. Because he was the one that was telling us, very close to God that he was, telling us how is the spiritual world, how is the possibility of us to grow completely different from everything that was said before him. And also nowadays is not understood. Because if we don't put this perspective of spirituality, we're going to be very shallow. We're not going to understand the question really deep. Okay, let's go ahead. So he said, right, my realm is not of this world. And he was there in front of Pontius Pilatus, right? My realm is not of this world. Nobody understood. So you're the king, they're saying you're the king. Okay, my realm is not of this world. What he was trying to say then? Nowadays, if we understand the spiritual world, we can understand. So the symbol of conquering heaven's realm is implicit. Jesus' will on the inner transformation of man. Because if he was saying that nothing that he's bringing is not belonging here, we have then to understand things in the other way. What other way? Let's see. Jesus' will is that man evolves morally and spiritually through the practice of noble acts and understanding the true concept of loving your neighbor. True concept. Okay, let's go ahead. Pretty obvious. But what inner reformation means for the person. What do we think about it? Let's think a little bit. Where do we come from? To where we go? What's the reason of life in the body? Like I said before, this can be very, very shallow. The Spiritist doctrine gives us directions to answer all these questions. But first, they're very philosophical. We have to consider philosophy. It's a way of thinking. There are many ways. Why we put also science, and we are living today, a very special moment of mankind where science is explaining all spirituality, all the effects of the spirit, all the life of the spirit. They say, oh, God is all places. Then the quantum mechanics told that, yes, one electron can be in infinite places at the same time. And it's not a reproduction. It's not a reflection. So things like that, expressions like that, are nowadays proved. We nowadays don't even need this doubt. Oh, they're saying that, but you know what? This is something that it's a possibility. It may happen, but may not. That time ended. Nowadays, the question of faith that we've been having for centuries is being resolved for us. Not even this doubt, not even this effort of looking for it, we don't have anymore. It's such a special time. It's such a special time, you know what? To be happy, to evolve, to follow Jesus. Because now Jesus is understandable, very understandable. Okay. We need to know how to think philosophically. So, in that way, we can educate ourselves. Yes, because without our intellect, without reason, nobody's capable of changing. Mostly the adult, rational adult. Mostly people like us, we speak, I don't know how many languages we speak. We study, we've been to the university, we know physics, mathematics. We know a lot of stuff. We learn a lot of stuff. We, for all these years that just AG, here to here, there's a lot of evolution on mankind. He was talking with people of shepherds, people with a low level of education. They were reading the Torah, the Bible, all that, but it's completely different. Some affirmatives that nowadays are proven. So now we can really be philosophical, scientific, and spiritual, because it drives us in that direction. And because of that, we have nowadays the obligation of picking up this opportunity and grow. Because on Earth, we are doing this move for regeneration. And we have to regenerate what? Ourselves. Use the opportunity that God gives us to reincarnate, because it's very clear. Reincarnation nowadays is something so clear. So we have to understand that if you have the opportunity over here, grab it and run. So that's another vision of the spirituality. Self-education. That's the more difficult education that we have. It's very easy to go to a shop, hey, learn this. I need to educate you. Go to school, go to university, go to college, education. But this education of ourselves, because of what we are responsible for building the path to our spirituality, many people didn't even awaken. 21 centuries, and we are not really awaken for the fact that we are spirits. The day that mankind understands that, that's the time where regeneration is done. It's done. So, we're responsible for building the path to our spirituality throughout our earthly experience. If we don't accept it, if we don't take the opportunity, let me tell you, I don't know where you're gonna lose in your time. Most of the time, we are unaware of what causes to have some reactions, attitudes, emotions, and thoughts. And why is that? Because mankind evolved scientifically, evolved philosophically. We know a lot of stuff, but we don't know ourselves. We don't know ourselves. We don't know some reactions that we have. Even though nowadays, on the Spiritist doctrine, we are having a lot of info about the mental field. And nowadays, science also together is giving us a chance to understand ourselves, our feelings. Understand, for instance, that instincts and emotions are not feelings. Instincts and emotions, we evolved from 20 million years, we are now capable of having thoughts that don't stop. Our thoughts, we never stop our thoughts. They run and run and run, even when we are sleeping. Right. After these 20 million years, we also stayed in the primitive, like Earth, we were in the caves and all that, chasing animals, fighting to eat and all that. And so we developed our defense, our reproduction instincts. And they are with us. In this part of the brain that we have, the lower part over here, they call the reptile brain. From the reptiles, yes. It's so old, because the reptiles were the first to come, right? Mm-hmm. Like dinosaurs and all that. So this is how old our emotions, our primitive emotions are. But even though nowadays there are many people that Divaldo Franco says that people from mouth down. Yes, because of that, because they're only instincts. So eat, sleep, make sex, and all that, and that's all in life that matters. Go to work, come back, and everything. There's no science, no philosophy, nothing like that. They're glad because they're living. Okay? Even the ones there are not choosing, think they're not choosing, they are. Even the ones that think they're not choosing, they are. So, probably they'll have to come many, many, many other times. But you know what? It's getting harder to come back. So our reactions, attitudes, we have to know that better. We have to. That is what we say, to know ourselves. To understand our reactions, our attitudes, emotions. Okay. When surprised by trouble, we review our inner struggle. Oh yeah, things start to not go to the direction we want. So we are surprised by trouble. It's not working out. Things are not the way I want to know. Everything I do. And you know what? There are some things in my life that they always happen the same. I got a marriage. My husband was one way. I divorced. I married again. It's the same. Many people say that. We do the same relationship. Why? Do we ever think why that happens? Okay, so we are surprised by trouble. We review our inner struggles under a lot of sorrow and frustration. Can you imagine? I got married once, it didn't work out. I thought it was forever. Love is not forever. lasts forever. But unfortunately, we got this frustration, this sorrow indeed, marks our because it didn't work out. But he used to do this, he used to do that. Okay, and what about you, my love? What did you do? Did you think about it? Turning the meeting with our own shade into something very uncomfortable. That's the problem. We don't want to see. It's uncomfortable. Because we think that we are, I'm so good. I don't do anything bad to anybody. I'm very calm. I don't respond to things. I don't discuss. Why should things happen to me that way? So, all of us, we have this side of virtue. The side is a shadow of us. Because we're not evolved spiritually. We all know that. We're not evolved spiritually. We are struggling with our own feelings, not knowing very well, driven by what? So, there's a conduct that may fit us. Having the habit of reviewing ourselves, meditating, and evaluating our behavior and moral makes it easier to find ourselves and take the path to transformation. Because one of the fantastic things that the doctrine, the Spiritist doctrine is doing now is saying that this century of transformation that we're going through, they send a lot of information about the mental field, and they send also many psychologists of the space, like Joana de Angelis, that found the fifth path, the fifth force of psychology, because it includes not only the concepts of Jung, some of Freud also, but also reincarnation, because we come over here with tendencies. And sometimes we don't understand why these tendencies are like that. Sometimes we don't even reach these tendencies because our memory erases. When we come over here, the memory, we lose the memory. But if we pay attention to ourselves, if we meditate, because meditate is a state that you hear God, your guardian angel, spirituality. You hear, you calm yourself down to hear, okay? So, when you hear, reviewing your attitudes, your feelings, why things happen that or that way. So, this is what makes ourselves ready for any kind of change or transformation. But then they're saying, most of the time we are unaware of what causes us to have some reactions, attitudes, emotions, and thoughts. Okay, this I said already, is the next. But then, very important, because in the doctrine they say that pride is one of the greatest problems that we have on earth nowadays. So, if we, let's be humble in a way that we recognize the meaning and the extension of our imperfections. It's not comfortable, I can assure you. Because when we touch our imperfections, it hurts. It's not comfortable at all. But otherwise, under the fascination of our pride, we believe we're better than we really are. Oh yes, I'm fantastic. I have a good house. I have a good job. Good money in my bank. Credit. My car is the last year. And so, People are very used to judge themselves about what they have, not what they are. We live in a society that's all driven by that. You're not what you are what you have. So you signify in society about what you have, what you're capable of achieving in this world. Is that wrong? No, we need that too. We're not against the matter or anything that we can achieve or fight for or be capable of doing in the material world. But there's more than that. That's the problem. So we are not even advised that we're doing here that we have to look the other way. Huh? In other way, when we feel that we can't get rid of our faults, our conscience gets in pain. Because the conscience is the so-called relation to God. The conscience always knows if what is right, what is wrong. Justice has a sense of just all of us. The kid has, the tribal man has that sense also. Everybody knows what's right, what's wrong. If you do something wrong and you don't disguise it even to yourself, there will be a moment that you're gonna stop and your conscience, you're gonna meditate and your conscience is gonna tell you if you're right or if you're wrong. Am I wrong? It's like that, right? It's not comfortable. It's not what we want sometimes. You want to then, no, I did that because, you know, I was very, somebody was teasing me. So that's why. Okay. But don't you have any control of yourself? Don't you have your own points of view? Okay. So, when this conscience tells us that we're wrong, we get in pain. There are many reactions for that pain. Each person is going to react differently. For some, that pressure of consciousness can be an awakening in the direction of transformation. That's what we're trying to advise people here on the doctrine, Spiritist doctrine too. So you can go to the love, God, the love progress, like we see in the gospel moment here. To others, a way to dispose of any inner renovation. Oh, you know what? Not me. Okay? Okay. So, understanding our own level of evolution is fundamental in reaching a higher goal. Because all of us have evolution. You can get stuck sometimes because you rebel. There are people that don't believe in anything. I don't want to believe in God, I don't believe in anything. You know what, I am what I am. I'm born that way, I'm gonna die that way. Okay. But everybody has some level of evolution passed by birth. And there is one thing that you're going to find in the dark, you're going to find in the gospel, saying that there is virtue. What is virtue? Because we say virtue, because, oh, it's so good, I'm so good. Everybody has virtue. There is virtue every time that with consciousness we resist the bad act or thought. What means that? That we have to have this consciousness. What we have to, in what direction we have to go? Of our consciousness. Getting closer to our consciousness. That's what it is. So, this is very interesting. Hahnemann is the one that created homeopathy, right? And he used to say that because people wrongly believe that their nature can't be changed, they often consider themselves relieved from the responsibility of trying to correct their faults. And that's why many people don't stay in Spiritism, because we start to understand that we have the responsibility of evolving, of doing something for ourselves, for our spirit. Some people, when they understand, it's very good to go there. People do their responsibilities, like they go to church, they pray, they are good fathers and mothers, take care of the kids, take care of the parents. That's okay. That's okay. Nobody's against that. But there is one responsibility with us and God that is very unique and very personal, one by one, that we have this to evolve. Blessed are the meek and the peacemakers. I love that. Chapter 9 of the Gospel. We have our degree of imperfections, but also virtue. Virtues are the essential qualities of a good person: generosity, charitableness, temperance, industriousness, modesty. We all have that too. And nobody, it's a thin line that we walk. Because, okay, I recognize that I have many imperfections. I recognize it. But you're not going to evolve through your imperfections, only through your virtues. So what we have to do is give value to the virtues. Is try, like they say in there, to go that way, on the way of the virtue. And the shadow that we also have is going to be lighted more and more by the virtue. So it's nothing that you can, oh, come on, you fight yourself, you fight the bad. No, you don't fight the bad, you do the good. Fight the bad is doing the good. That's all. Very simple. That's the bottom line there. A wholehearted dedication to our virtues promotes our spiritual growth and enlightens our shadow. That's what I was saying. So, let's read Matthew here. Come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Jesus said all that, which really is compact of what we always said before. Being humble in the heart, gentle. So trying to put a good side out all the time. Living with Jesus can do that. Jesus teaches us with what kind of heart we should embrace our changes, exactly what I said now. Turning our transformation into something easy and light. It's not difficult. It's not difficult. It's not science. It's not something a child cannot do. Don't need to be, like we say here, a rocket science. Rocket scientist, like we say. Recognition of our achievements and virtues with no martyrdom for what we couldn't reach yet. Yes, because, like we say all the time, nature jumps, right? So it's going to be slowly loving, starting with us. This that Jesus said, love God above all, and should be love yourself so you can love the neighbor. We have this concept that loving ourselves is egoism, but it's not. If you don't love yourself, you can't love your neighbor, not even God. You have to find the love you have in you. Because that's love that's going to make you change. We used to say that everything you can't do, you don't do, for love you do. Think about your child. How many things you do because of your child that you wouldn't do? You wouldn't do. For a mother that you wouldn't do, but you do. So, we're finishing. So, let's make the best of us take place in our lives. If your heart is light, so is your conscience. The seeds of the divine love, justice, goodness, and beauty are in your consciousness. So beautiful. That's how we're created. As children of God, created at God's image, the closer we get to that conscience, the closer we get to God, opening the path of our spirituality and moral evolution, putting in action the teachings of Jesus Christ. Thank you very much. Have a wonderful night and week. I hope that I come.